I have here a Fujitsu Lifebook U810 Ultra Micro PC. And this came out in late 2007, which is about the same time as netbooks started appearing. And this PC has a special function in which the screen can actually rotate right around and the whole unit can turn into a tablet. And it comes with a stylus and a resistive touchscreen. I've decided I want to upgrade the hard drive in this with a solid state drive and then see if I can install Windows 7. We'll have a quick look around the unit. On the side here is a wireless on-off switch. We've got the power input. There's a full-sized SD card slot. There's a rocker for volume up and down and headphone and microphone. And this goes to the dock or accessory connector. We've got status lights there. And there's the main power switch and the USB. And of course a compact flash card slot right in there. This machine was built for Windows Vista, and there's the back label. It's known as the U810 mostly, but in some markets it's known as the U1010. So it should be pretty simple to replace the hard drive in this. There's just this back plate here, and I believe the hard drive is just sitting under here. And the hard drive I'll be installing is an SSD, a 32GB one, which will be replacing the 30GB spinning hard drive. And this is an mSATA device. mSATA cards look identical to mPCIe. In fact, they're pretty much completely the same physically, but the protocol is totally different. So you do have to watch what sort of slot you've got and what sort of card you're installing when dealing with these two formats. To adapt the mSATA to what's in here, I have an adapter which will convert, this will adapt an mSATA SSD to a parallel ATA ZIF adapter, and that's just what we need to get this up and running. Okay, there we go, there's our module. So let's get this open and get our new SSD installed in this computer. I won't be doing a complete teardown of this, but if you want to see what the main board looks like, there is a video on YouTube which someone has made and has pictures of the insides. I'll link that below. Okay, so with the back panel loose, we can just take that off. And inside we have, there's an mPCIe slot with an mPCIe wireless card in it. And there's our hard drive that we're going to be replacing today. So let's get that out. Get it out of its rubber supports. And there's our ZIF connector, which just comes off very easily. And this PCI, this connector is really quite loose. And even with the latch closed, the cable won't stay in. So I'm going to have to just thicken it up a little bit with some tape. Okay, I've added a bit of tape onto the connector there to thicken it up. I may as well take the battery off. We can see it is built for Windows Vista and has an Intel Inside sticker on it. Okay, now let's see if we can get this connected. Yeah, that feels a lot better. Okay, that's quite snug. Close the door. Yeah, although that really is... Okay, just a little bit of double-sided tape inside just to hold it steady. This may not be the permanent solution, but it's enough just to keep it for now. And we'll put the back cover on. And I'm just going to put one screw in it for now. Okay, to update the operating system, I have a USB CD-ROM drive, or DVD burner as in this case. And we've got our power cable for the computer. We'll put the battery back on. Okay, there's all our components set up, and it should be as simple as that. So let's get, first of all, I'm going to start with Windows 10 to see if it will actually install onto this computer. And this is the latest version, 1803, and it's of course the 32-bit version, because this is a 32-bit CPU in here. So that spins up, let's boot up and do an install. Okay, computer is booting. And it looks like check time and date settings are bad in the BIOS. Alright, let's go into setup and have a look. Function F2. Alright, so it hasn't detected our hard drive. Well, that... Alright, we have to take the back off and have another look. Find out why it's not detecting our hard drive. I think the reason we don't have a detection is because this is going to have to go in upside down. We've got the double-sided tape now on the other side, and that should just sort of sit like that. Okay, let's try that again. That looks good. There's our light on drive connected. Okay, it's going to have a go at installing Windows 10. We'll have a quick look and see what that's like. I would prefer Windows 7 on this computer. But it'll be interesting to see what Windows 10 is like before switching to Windows 7. Just as a comparison. Okay, so Windows 10 is definitely not compatible with this computer. So that's good to know, and we'll get on with the process of upgrading this computer with an operating system that actually works. Okay, now switching to Windows 7 32-bit version. Okay, Windows 7 is beginning its install function. Okay. I accept your terms, Microsoft. Let's continue, please. Upgrade or custom? I guess we want custom. Okay, so this drive has an operating system on it already, obviously. So we're going to... I think what we'll do is delete both partitions and start again. Okay, we can create a new partition, just the whole size, that will do. Let's continue with the install, copying files. No worries. We'll let that go and see what happens. Okay, we've got Windows 7 Ultimate. Type a username. Okay, we have a Windows 7 desktop. So it seems like the Windows 7 experience is not fantastic on this computer. And I don't want to install Vista on here. So I think maybe this computer might be better off with Windows XP tablet version. So while we're here at this point, I will just mention that this on the side here is indeed a biometric finger scanner to read your fingerprint. And I don't have the docking unit for this, which I'll show you a picture of it here from the user manual. But I do have this adapter here, which has VGA and wired network, and that just plugs in there. And if you plug a USB hub in the side, then you pretty much got all the functionality that the dock would provide, except for the ease of use and convenience that a dock has. So it's a fairly well optioned machine, and I think it might be better off with Windows XP. I'm really torn because I would prefer Windows 7 on this computer, but I just it's almost okay, but I think trying XP tablet is a good way to go. At least I know what it's like, and especially since I've only just recently installed tablet on another computer, and this is really my first time with Windows XP tablet, and it's, you know, it's an interesting experience. So I may as well try it on two computers at the same time and do a bit of a comparison between the two. Computer name. Twister. No account password needed at this time. And that date is crazy wrong. Setup is almost complete. Well, this is interesting. The installation looks to be a bit different this time from when I installed on the Veo. I think it's because last time it was a network boot install and it couldn't install the extra, and there was an error that I had to cancel. This time it's installing from an optical disk, and so it's just adding all the extra. Okay, it's almost complete. We're going to adjust the screen resolution, and yep, that's fine. We'll keep that. Finish. First boot into Windows XP tablet on this computer. Okay, XP tablet edition. There it is. It's all done. This has got just the default XP theme on it. And considering the performance of this unit, I want to run a benchmark. So I'm going to do that now. There's the activation request in 30 days. And as far as I'm aware, Microsoft is not activating XP anymore, so I'm going to have to work out some way to deal with that. In the meantime, I want to benchmark this and compare it to the previous Veo that I did an upgrade to. So I'm going to run a Prime 95 benchmark. And we'll let that run and see what sort of results we get. Okay, there's our benchmark results with Prime 95. And we'll do a comparison with the Veo now. So just a bit of a size comparison while that's starting up. So they're similar, but the Fujitsu does have a keyboard hidden under there, and the battery does stick out here. Okay, I've run the benchmark on both units, and the Veo from 2004 is definitely outperforming the Fujitsu from 2007, and that's the Fujitsu Lifebook U810. Done. I do have one more ultra micro PC that I'd like to look at one day, perhaps not soon, but perhaps one day in the future, and that's, I think, one of the very first, and I've had this unit since 2001. But for now, we'll have a quick look at the Pocketables review of the Fujitsu from back in the day.